Oh, as far as definitely be appointed, say that emergency, he just be appointed.
Good evening. I'm going to call the Salem Housing Authority for meeting for March 12th to order. If the city recorder would please call the roll.
Commissioner Tesler.
Present.
Commissioner Nanki.
Here.
Commissioner Clausen.
Here.
Commissioner Dickey.
Here.
Commissioner Thomas.
Here.
Commissioner Clem.
Here.
Chair Bennett.
Here. Will you please join me in the Pledge of Allegiance?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All right, we have no one signed up for public comment to the Housing Authority. Is there anyone that would like to address the Housing Authority at this time? All right. Commissioner Nanki, the consent calendar, please.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I would move the consent calendar as provided.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Andy, you know, I apologize. Oh, you're
we
under
did that again.
Yeah.
It's like,
we just keep going by you here. Andy, is there anything you wanted to highlight? I apologize.
Really quickly, Mr. Chairman, I appreciate the commissioner's attention to the tours we're trying to get together. And we encourage you to find a time. And if we're not offering up times that work for you, please make an offer to us and we'll accommodate that to go out and look at the portfolio. Commissioner Nanki, you had asked expressly about homeless counts in the past. I still don't have the homeless count from the Mid-Willamette Valley's survey, but I do have the homeless count as far as the number of homeless individuals that SHA is serving right now, which is 138 total. We have several general voucher programs where we set aside vouchers for homeless individuals. And we have also special purpose vouchers that we use specifically, say, for veterans or families that are unifying. So happy to provide that information. We can continue to include that in our reports.
Councilor Nanki.
Actually, I just wanted to say excellent story on Pavel in regards to the Family Self-Sufficiency Program as well. It's always heartening to see that.
Right, right. Thank you.
I just want to follow up on Andy's invitation to members of the Housing Authority to take a tour of the scattered housing. I did it last week, right. And it was very interesting, very informative, and ultimately persuasive that we need to take a look at this issue very carefully. So I appreciated the opportunity. I hope others will, if you have time, do it. It's a good chance. All righty. We have no special order business, no unfinished business, no new business. Without objection, this meeting is adjourned.
Well, good evening, everyone. I will now call to order this meeting of the Urban Renewal Agency of the City of Salem, our meeting for March 12, 2012. Would the recorder please call the roll?
Board Member Bennett.
Here.
Board Member Tesler.
Present.
Board Member Nanki.
Here.
Board Member Clausen.
Here.
Board Member Dickey.
Here.
Board Member Thomas.
Here.
Board Member Clem.
Here.
Chair Peterson.
Here. Good evening, everyone. And Member Bennett, would you like to propose a motion with regard to the consent calendar?
Yes, Madam Mayor. I move the consent calendar.
Second.
It's been moved by Member Bennett and seconded by Member Nanki to move the consent calendar. Is there any discussion? I'll call for the question. All those in favor of adopting the consent calendar as presented, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, say nay. Motion carries unanimously. Thank you. There's an information report in your council packet and online, so be sure to see if you have, does anyone have any questions about that? All right, we have no special orders of business this evening, no unfinished business, and no public hearings. Is there any new business that should come before the Urban Renewal Agency? Hearing, seeing none, our meeting is adjourned. All right, we will now move on to the opening for our city council meeting for March 12th. Would the recorder please call the roll?
Councilor Bennett.
Here.
Councilor Tesler.
Present.
Councilor Nanki.
Here.
Councilor Clausen.
Here.
Councilor Dickey.
Here.
Councilor Thomas.
Here.
Councilor Clem.
Here.
Mayor Peterson.
Here. Thank you. We'll first have approval of additions and deletions. Councilor Bennett?
Madam Mayor, I move additions to the council agenda 3.3F and 5D.
All right. Is there a second?
Second.
It's been moved by Councilor Bennett and seconded by Councilor Nanki to move the addition of the action of the addendums to the additions to this evening's City Council agenda. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, say nay. Motion carries unanimously. All right. Council comment. Do we have any councilors who would like to share comments with us this evening? Yes, Councilor Nanki.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. At the North St. Anne Watershed Council meeting last week, we had PGE come and speak to us in regards to the Cascade Crossing, which is a new 500 kV line that's running from the Boardman area to just east of Salem. They did an open house here on Saturday. I think they have one more up in Mill City later this week, but if anybody's interested in that and couldn't make any of the others, they could hit the PGE website to find out the exact date, time, and place for that meeting. They're planning on paralleling the existing lines. There'll be some alternate locations right up and around the Brighton Bush area because of topography and what have you. But other than that, it'll pretty much follow. They'll have to widen the cut for where the line's actually set. And then there's a louder buzz with the 500 kV stuff. And they're dealing with all the landowners along that route.
Good. All right, thank you. Other comments from councilors? I'd like to take just a moment and remember that today, actually 1 year ago, was the Great East Japan earthquake and subsequent disasters, and City Manager Linda Norris and I were able to attend a commemoration reception today in Portland. The Consul General of Japan and Mrs. Okabe hosted that. And it really was a wonderful opportunity to meet so many people from around the Salem, Portland, Western Oregon area who joined together to provide aid to Japan a year ago and in many cases days and days and days since then right up to now. And it gives me great pleasure to tell the people of Salem that their expressions of grief and condolence and their aid were greatly appreciated by the people of Japan. And again, Oregon and Salem were well on the map, recognizing that we have very close partners and very close friendships with people in Japan and people of Japan who are here. And it was really just an honor for me to be there and represent Salem. City Manager Norris, would you like to say something?
We heard many stories of from people who were actually there at the time and what they experienced and what their families experienced. I think one of the very moving things was how people just pulled together in absolutely incredible devastation, and everyone just set out working to try to find hope and to try to get into recovery and reconstruction as fast as they could, although there's still just horrendous barriers to go through yet in the cleanup. That some of the after photographs we saw, it's just amazing how much progress they've made to date.
Right. Thank you. All right. If there are no further comments by council members, we're going to go right into our calendar and public comment. Do we have someone signed up?
Yeah.
We do. All right. Nancy Croft. Am I reading this correctly, Nancy?
I actually thought it was 3.3A.
Well, it is 3.3A, but we invite people to provide public comment at this point in the agenda. Does that work okay for you? Okay.
Madam Mayor.
Welcome.
Council. My name is Nancy Baker Croft, spelled B-A-K-E-R hyphen K-R-O-F-F-T for the record. I live on Catterland Street, but I lived at 15th Street for 34 years in the city of Salem. It was my great pleasure to go to the state fair with my son in a prior reign of a different mayor and bring home a chicken. That chicken was 7 years old and died Friday. Well, my son has been fighting City Hall to legalize chickens. I am very delighted to see that this member 3.3A is on today's agenda, and I am very grateful to my councilman in Ward 1, Mr. Bennett, who informed me that this is going to be on tonight, and I urge all of your aye vote.
Thank you. Are there questions? Well, thank you very much. We appreciate you coming down. If there's no further public comment, we'll proceed to our consent calendar. Councilor Bennett?
Thank you, Madam Mayor. I move the consent calendar.
Second.
It's been moved by Councilor Bennett and seconded by Councilor Tesler to move the consent calendar. I believe Councilor Nanke, do you have comments?
Yeah, I'll be recusing on 3.3A because of previous discussions in regards to potential financial benefit to myself.
I see. Okay, thank you. Are there other further comments? All right, seeing none, all those in favor of approving the consent calendar signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed, say nay. Motion carries with Councilor Nanke abstaining. Okay, we now move to the public hearings. We'll see where we are with public hearings. We do have a public hearing this evening on agenda item 4A. Would the recorder please read the, let's see.
Because it's continued, we can just go.
Oh, you don't need to read it. Okay, that's okay. No, that's my error, Kathy. We're fine. All right, we'll go into testimony. We have
Madam Mayor.
Oh, excuse me.
Madam Mayor, I'm sorry.
Yes.
If I could. I need to disclose that I've had ex parte contact and also make the statement per the city charter that I feel that that discussion that that I had with the applicant and his engineer does not affect my decision at all. The discussion happened on May 15th at approximately 10 a.m. Near my place of business, and the discussion was were concerns of the neighborhood being addressed as the applicant continued to apply for annexation. And so they felt that they were, and it was at that time that I contacted the city manager's office to have this public hearing sort of go forth. So I wanted to make sure that I made that disclosure and believe that it doesn't affect my ability to vote on this. So okay. With that disclosure, I believe I've fulfilled the requirements.
Thank you. What was the date that you said?
February 15th.
Oh, I thought you said May. I didn't think it could be May 15th.
Oh,
February. You did just say February. Good. All right.
And okay. We have a staff presentation, Mayor.
Yeah.
All right.
I have not seen any information with regard to what's in the packet here. We just had that conversation about this going forward. So.
Fine. Okay. That's fine. And we do have a staff report first, or a staff presentation, before we actually move on to the public hearing. Good evening.
Good evening. I'm Pamela Cole, and I'm presenting the staff report for annexation case number C74. I request that the staff report and its attachments be entered into the official record. In addition to Oregon revised statutes that govern annexations, the Salem Charter requires voter approval for most annexations. City Council usually reviews several annexation cases in the spring to determine which annexations to refer to the voters for November election. The hearing for this petitioner-initiated annexation was opened on January 23rd for consideration for the May 15th, 2012 election. Council continued that hearing to June 25th, 2012, and the applicants then requested that the annexation be moved to the November 6th, 2012 ballot. On February 27th, Council rescheduled that continued hearing to this evening. The petitioners request annexation of just over 1.4 acres in the 1900 block of Wallace Road Northwest, and staff is recommending annexation of 0.2 acres of right-of-way in Wallace Road Northwest. The request this evening is to keep the multifamily residential comprehensive plan designation, zone the territory multiple family residential 1, or RM1, and withdraw from the Salem Suburban Rural Fire Protection District. The annexation territory is located on the east side of Wallace Road Northwest between Valley Street Northwest and Herrick Drive Northwest and across from Linda Lane Northwest. It currently includes single family dwellings and an accessway. In this aerial photograph, you can see the existing single family dwellings. The white screen is over the area that's outside of city limits. You can also see existing residential development and some vacant property, some agricultural uses surrounding the territory. Linda Lane across the Wallace Road Northwest serves several duplexes and several four-unit multifamily buildings, while other areas west of Wallace are primarily developed with single-family dwellings. Further north, there are apartments on Herrick Drive. The petitioners originally requested that the northern part of the annexation territory would be annexed along with a zone change to RM2 zoning, multiple family residential 2, and the southern parcel would be annexed as RM1. RM2 zoning would allow 12 to 28 units per acre, while RM1 zoning allows 8 to 14 units per acre. To fulfill the application requirements for that zone change request, the petitioners submitted a conceptual plan showing 24 apartment units on the eastern parcel. The Planning Commission reviewed the zone change request on December 6, 2011, and recommended that Council adopt the proposed RM2 zone designation in light of the conceptual plan. Staff included that recommendation in our previous report to Council prior to the January 23rd annexation hearing. The petitioners subsequently withdrew that zone change request and withdrew the conceptual plan on February 29th, and staff revised our report for tonight's annexation hearing. The entire territory would be annexed RM1 if voters approve the annexation as requested tonight. The proposed annexation would also create an enclave. Shown here in blue, Council could initiate an annexation of this enclave in the future with or without approval of the property owners. The purpose of public hearing tonight is to give Council the opportunity to determine whether the petition is consistent with state law, whether the proposal meets the criteria for annexation, and whether to refer the annexation to the voters for the November 6th election. If council decides tonight to refer to the annexation to the voters, council will receive a second staff report later and then have the opportunity to review and approve the resolution, ballot measure, explanatory statement, and fact sheet for the annexation. The annexation criteria are found in SRC Chapter 165. They include consistency of land use designations with comprehensive plan and statewide planning goals, whether the proposed boundary, land uses, and density allow orderly, efficient, and timely provision of urban services, and whether referral of the annexation would serve the public interest. Staff found that the proposal met the annexation criteria and included our findings as Exhibit 3 of Attachment A of the staff report. In general, the city supports annexations because they allow the city to provide efficient services, promote compact urban growth within the urban growth boundary, provide developable land, and allow the community to share the cost of urban services. Staff recommends that council find that the petition's in conformance with state laws, determine that the annexation satisfies the local laws, and adopt an order, which is Attachment A of the staff report, and refer the proposed annexation, the comprehensive plan and zoning designations, and the withdrawal from the Salem Suburban Rural Fire Protection District to the voters for the November 6th ballot. That includes my presentation, but I'm available to answer questions.
Thank you. We will proceed to the testimony of two individuals who've signed up, and then we will go back to questions of staff. First person signed up is Herb Shaw.
Oh, we go to him.
I'm sorry. All right, so now I've been told that actually Hans Tykeson should speak first. Sorry. He is the applicant. Okay. I'm sorry, Mr. Shaw, I didn't mean to get you up too early. Okay.
It was early this morning.
All right. Welcome. Good evening.
Good evening, Madam Mayor and council members. My name is Hans Tygeson. I reside at 2290 Michael Drive, Westland, Oregon, 97068. I am the petitioner on this project. I feel like we've been able to meet concerns of city staff members and council members. I think it's a good plan. We've come back with and tried to be real receptive with this RM1 zoning and our site plan. Anyway, I feel like it's a good plan, and I believe we're gonna have the city's best interests in mind. Thank you.
Thank you. Are there questions? Councillor Tesler.
Thank you for your testimony. The last time you were here, you referred to a storm drainage system off of your development that was being channeled into the slough. Did you take a look at that storm drainage system and change it, or do you still have a really, you had a small settling pond and?
Yeah, all detention's being dealt with on site.
And did you enlarge the pond and?
That we're dealing with, you know, it all meets the storm detention guidelines, and so there's no storm going to be handled off-site.
Okay, I'll reserve my other questions for staff.
All right, other questions? All right, thank you very much. Thank you. All right, and now Mr. Herb Shaw. Mr. Shaw, you have 3 minutes, and the red light will come on. The amber light comes on at the end of 2 and the red at the end of 3. Welcome.
Good evening, Mayor and Council. As a supplement to the letter that we submitted to the Council on January 23rd, 2012, we're still gravely concerned with any further housing development in West Salem. It is unconscionable and irresponsible to continue increasing traffic volumes in West Salem with no established plan to alleviate the bottleneck at the river crossing. As defenders of public safety, you must get serious about this and other developments. It is no different than purchasing and delivering a house full of new furniture with the hopes that you might someday find a house that you could afford to rent or to buy. We are also concerned that the proposed intersection that we will be sharing with this development is not being addressed to resolve the real safety issues that have been identified but ignored throughout this process. You are creating a death trap at this intersection. It is likely our concerns will be ignored in the name of community development, but nonetheless, if and when this development is approved, we want to go on record by requesting a substantial natural screening along the north roadway easement line of our common driveway, extending the full length of the current Vanderweiden property, which is lot number 604. We must have this to maintain a semblance of security, noise abatement, and aesthetic serenity from the tenants that will inhabit this facility. We are aware that a precedent has been set within the city, and we ask that this privilege be extended to us as well. We've attached a photo of what we have now looking out our driveway at the front of our house, but which will be removed according to the development plan. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Are there any questions for Mr. Shaw? Councillor Clem?
Yes, thank you, Mr. Shaw. When you say this, what will be removed with the development plan in your last sentence, are you referring to the white fence?
No, that's my property.
That's your property. So you're talking about the hedgerow of
the hedge,
vegetation?
Yes.
Okay, and so that hedge separates, is there now, and with the development, that will come down?
That'll all come down. That hedge line is on that easement line that I'm talking about for our common driveway.
Okay, all righty, thank you.
Councillor Dickey.
Thank you, Mayor. So looking at this photo that you submitted, the hedge, where does your property line rest?
Where I'm standing in this photo, my back is to my garage, and this is my front, this fence is my front yard, looking out my front window.
Okay, so does your property line go, is it, your property is that driveway and the hedge, or does it end at your driveway?
My property line is the center of that 20-foot easement.
Okay.
Mr. Shaw, I've added a photo on the screen that I took when I did a site visit back in November. So it shows on the right the white picket fence.
Right there is the driveway. And this photo was taken with their back to Wallace Road, looking to the east, and the development property is, well, at this point, to this corner right there, all of this area is Thigason's property, but this corner here, the easement goes, sure is wiggly. Couldn't be me. right there someplace is my property line, and there's a 10-foot easement on each side from the corner of that white fence you see there. This corner back there is the one, I can hold that thing still, right there. That's the corner you're looking at in the photo that I submitted.
All right, thank you.
All right, other questions? All right, thank you very much. We appreciate you coming down, appreciate your photos, or the photo from the staff. All right. I believe that we had some questions for staff, so if you would please come back to the podium.
Is this all right?
Yes. Oh, yes. All right. I believe that there was a question. Councillor Tesler, did you want to ask a follow-up question?
Thank you. You have excellent memory. I'm looking at the application. I remember the first time this came up, we talked a little bit about the urban growth development permit. And it says underneath storm drainage, a 24-inch storm line is located in Wallace Road Northwest. Due to the topographic constraints, the storm line may not be available to serve the subject property. The nearest public storm facility is a slough to the east of the subject property. I was a little concerned about this language, and I was wondering if this had been cleaned up or the situation had been remedied. Can someone speak to that?
Vicki Hardenwoods, Community Development Director. I have not heard that there's been any further development on that. I'm not sure if Public Works has looked at those plans or not.
If you'd like, I can help maybe speak to that.
Sure. My name is Keith Wissenhunt. I'm a consultant for the applicant. And we've continued to look at the storm drainage issue. And there are a couple things that has evolved in the plan. First of all, there was some discussion about the potential of a pipe that would go down to the slough fairly close to this site. That plan at this time is no longer being pursued. The drainage is going to be treated, detained on site, and then released as it is as it flows off the site today. And then it's going to travel as it does today. So there, as far as the stormwater management and stormwater treatment, we're going to be dealing with that in a fashion that's mimics the conditions today as closely as can be done. And then as additional development is completed to the north and to the east, then those facilities will deal with the drainage, and the amount of drainage will be no more than it is today with the undeveloped condition. Does that help?
So you're building drainage, you're building a stormwater detention facility that is only going to accommodate what part you're developing now, but you're going to develop more in the future, and what you're building now does not accommodate future build out?
Well, the requirements of Oregon Drainage Law and the City of Salem require that each development mitigate their stormwater runoff. And what is being proposed as part of this plan, and will be further developed if this annexation moves forward, is the entire site that's being developed as part of this plan will be dealt with in a manner that treats and detains that stormwater in a fashion in compliance with the Oregon and Salem drainage requirements.
Okay.
But we won't be dealing with any water off-site, but we will be dealing with all the water that's on-site. Does that answer your question?
Yes. I'm going to interrupt for just a second, because I want to be sure that for the record, we have your name and your company, and it was rather unusual for you to come to the microphone to begin talking about this.
Yes,
in
and
that
I apologize
we,
for that.
This should really,
be part of the public testimony. So your name and your business?
Sure, my name's Keith Wissenhunt, and my company is Project Delivery Group, 3150 22nd Street, Southeast Salem.
Okay. Yes, yeah. I actually would staff this, like to go back to the microphone and
this would be part of
answer
rebuttal.
The questions.
Well, I don't know that he had any specific questions. What I would like to do is to remind the council that what's on your agenda tonight is whether this property should be annexed. I know that there any development there, the original application that you saw on this actually asked to increase the zoning density in this area. The applicant has withdrawn that, so you don't see a site plan any longer with this proposal as you did before. So what's on the table tonight is, should this property be annexed, or should it be referred to the voters for annexation? There may be some questions about stormwater management, and we could follow up and get you those answers when we get a solid proposal. I'm not sure we've actually got a plan that's approvable yet from the applicants. I'm not sure they're quite far enough along to have that. They will be required to meet the standards that our codes require.
Thank you. I appreciate that clarification. So what we're really focusing on, the only thing we're focusing on, is the application for to go on to the ballot for annexation. Now, let's see, who has questions? I believe Councillor Bennett, and then Councillor Nanke, and then Councillor Claussen, and Councillor Tesler, do you have, you? Okay. All right, Councillor Bennett.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. I wanted to just check in, Vicki, on this again. Reading the findings, okay? The petitioners have met the annexation, petition, application, information submission, fee, waiver, and all other requirements to initiate the annexation. They've done all that.
Yes.
And that is the fundamental requirement for us to look at in order to move this along. Is that, am I understanding correctly? In other words, I'm concerned, like Councillor Tesler, with future storm drainage issues. I'm really concerned about these traffic issues. I think that they are ongoing. This is, do you know what I mean? But I'm not sure I'm allowed to take all that into consideration as I deal with this question. That's what I want to understand.
Here is specifically what you are supposed to consider when you make these decisions, and it's in your staff report on page 6. And Pamela went through it on the screen for you, but are the land use designations proposed consistent with our rules and regulations and our comprehensive plan for the city? Does it result in a boundary in which services can be provided in an orderly, efficient, and timely manner? Are the uses and densities that will be allowed, can they be served through the orderly, efficient, and timely extension of key urban facilities and services? And is the public interest furthered by the referral of the annexation? So that's kind of a broad list, but that's what you consider as criteria as to whether this should be referred to the ballot.
And so what the petitioner did was take this back and sort of rework it. And they have come back, as I understand it, with they're asking for a zoning that is really less than they have now.
Well, it's the same.
Same.
It should
okay.
be the same.
RM1 is the same as the current zoning.
They're applying a similar zone in the city that they have in the county, yes.
So their annexation then, they need to annex what, to get water?
I think probably to get all kinds of services there.
Okay.
Water, sewer, all kinds of services.
Okay. So this property can't be developed as it sits in the county, even with its current zone?
Not at this level.
Okay.
I think the dilemma here is that as a council, you have the right to determine whether this should be referred to the ballot. Once it's referred to the ballot and it's annexed, it becomes like any other piece of property in the city. If it meets the rules, we'll issue permits. If it is something that requires approval by the council, it will come here. But they could come up with a proposal that has apartments on that. It fully meets all of our rules. We go through site plan review, and you all would not see it again. And so this is an opportunity, if you have concerns, to say, well, we don't think it meets this criteria and it shouldn't be referred to the ballot. We don't believe that's true in this case. We believe that we need this kind of land within our city. We have to accommodate. We know we need multiple family housing. This adds to that supply. And we think that our rules and regulations will address the issues.
But we can, at this point, as Councillor Tesler has done, hopefully I've done, Mr. Shaw's done, red flag issues of real concern to
you
us.
You bet.
Now's the time to do it?
This may be your opportunity to do that. Of course, you can always have input with the state. I mean, you can always talk to us about what issues are with development, but this is the time when you're going to see it in front of you for sure.
So did you take a note, the concern about,
I'm
you
sure
see what
that
I mean?
The Public Works Department has lots of notes on the stormwater
okay.
management.
Thank you.
Okay, Councillor Nanke.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. Interesting in how basically it's just like any other annexation. I just want to annex, here it is. That's what the base zoning is, and that's what's bringing it forward. So a lot of those things that we could potentially do with the zone change are taken away from us now, and it's essentially meet the criteria only.
The difference there is that with the zone change, there's a concept plan that comes with that and gets approved, and it has to be, and which is very broad. It wouldn't typically include stormwater management anyway, but still they would have to develop aligned with that concept plan.
But even still, after annexation, after the waiting period, they could petition to zone change the property as well.
Yes.
Question I had, and possibly the petitioner will address it in rebuttal. You had indicated there's no site plan. There's really nothing we have with this annexation. Yeah. The previous one had the conceptual drawing, but I could have sworn I heard the petitioner say with the changes we've made and the new site layout.
Well, they probably have something in mind, and we may even have seen it, but I haven't seen it personally, and it's not really part of this application.
Yeah, it's not part of this, so it would just something, because I couldn't ask the question at the time because I was scrolling down through because I didn't remember seeing anything new and different.
For good reason.
Thanks.
Okay. Councillor Clausen.
Well, I wanted to say thank you to Mr. Shaw for coming down for public testimony. I appreciate that anytime we get public in here talking about things. So to his concern on the screen wall, maybe staff could say when his concern is best aired in the process after this, because it doesn't sound like the screen wall would be part of this conversation.
No, it may not be, and I think I would ask either Pamela or Glenn Gross to respond to that question for you.
We did that at 7. We've screened that.
Yeah, I think. So Pamela, can you speak to that?
Currently, we have a site plan review and a design review application in for the properties that are already in the city. Those are at 1950 and 1980 Wallace. Those are both zoned RM2. Those applications have not been deemed complete because of the uncertainty with the other property and how things will fit together in the future if this is annexed. We do have design review standards and buffer yard standards that require area between a property line and an adjacent property. It's a little unusual in this situation because part of the property is outside the city right now, but that would be coming in for a pre-application conference for design review at some point before they can apply for site plan review.
Pamela, could you put that map up and show specifically what you're speaking about?
If I could clarify the question just a little bit too. I think it's more for Mr. Shaw's benefit in terms of when is his time to put in his comment for that question, because that's what I get a lot from public. When we're doing a development, what's the time for public input?
Well, I think
if there is a time in this situation.
Part of this, of the adjacent properties outside the city limits, that may limit his ability to put in too much comment, and I think that's what Pamela is trying to point out here.
And I didn't bring the design review handbook up with me this evening, and I'm not personally involved in the design review on this project, but one of my coworkers has been, and they will be doing a pre-application conference for the parcel that's at 1936 Wallace, which is the larger piece that's 1 acre.
Can you point to that one?
I don't have a pointer with me. I can point with the cursor.
Okay.
But it's the larger piece there. So there would be a design review pre-app for that, and pre-applications aren't open to the public. But I think that the applicant and his engineer are hearing your comments. So it's this piece, the larger one, that would be under the proposed zoning of RM1, there could be up to 14 units placed on that property. When they previously did the conceptual plan with the request for the zone change, they were proposing 24. So it's been reduced by 10. And that design review would affect this parcel, and it would also affect the access parcel that comes in with that. The current design review application and site review applications that we received and are reviewing are the larger parcel at 1980 and the smaller one at 1950 Wallace, which are already zoned RM2.
And Madam Mayor?
Those are pending.
If I may, Glenn Gross, Urban Planning Administrator. I want to make sure that we give a real clear answer to what I understood Councilor Klassen's question to be. The time for Mr. Shaw or any other neighbor to comment on a proposed development is during site plan review, but to be very clear, that's only if it's a what we call a type 2 site plan review or a site plan review that's subject to notice and opportunity for comment by the neighbors. It's possible that the applicant in this case could give us a site plan that meets all of the standards, all of the clear and objective standards, which would mean it would be processed as a type 1 site plan review, and it would be just like getting a building permit. There would be no opportunity to comment.
Okay. That's what I was looking for. Thank you.
And if I may add, there's also a design review process that runs either as an administrative design review if they meet all of the standards in the design handbook, or if they don't meet those standards, then they can apply for guidelines review. And if that's the case, that would go to Planning Commission, and there would be opportunities for public participation.
And a point of clarification on the zoning is binding for a period of 5 years on the property. It's not just a simple rezone. It's a higher standard.
I believe Councillor Clem had his hand up, and then Councillor Nanke, and then Councillor Dickey.
Sure. Thank you, Madam Mayor. Mm-hmm. I'll try to save my comments for when we deliberate. Just a couple of questions of staff. Just want to confirm. council has conditioned annexations previously.
Yes.
And has done so for the purpose of mitigating the impacts to nearby residences with regard to visibility and traffic noise.
Yes, you have.
So conditioning, I just want to confirm that we have done this before.
Yes.
In a rural setting that was becoming urbanized where zoning wasn't changed. So I just want to make sure that the second question I have is related to natural screening that Mr. Shaw brings up, and we certainly want to hear from the applicant during rebuttal, but or when we get to that point. But city requires a 20-foot buffer normally now if this property were in the city. Could staff confirm what a reasonable what the standard is now for that buffer distance?
Councilor Clem, I think I understand your question. You're asking if it were in the city today and the adjacent property were in the city and it came in, what would the landscape buffer requirement be? I asked Pamela that earlier, and we think it would be 20 feet, just as you just referred to.
Yeah. And that would be for a building that's over one story. So, and we're presuming that these would be over one story.
Councilor Nanke, I believe you are next.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. And yeah, to follow up on Councilor Clem's point, I was trying to recall whether or not that screening requirement was actually part of the annexation when we did it, or was it part of a development?
It was part of the annexation.
Okay.
And I believe it was actually a tree preservation requirement, yes. Not a screening requirement. Yes. There was a
correct.
There was a
that was
a,
the Sonica property
of,
way out south.
Yeah, there was a line of old, I believe, red cedars. Large trees that you guys wanted to preserve.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
But and that was a significant distance. Can someone show me exactly where the hedge is and how long it actually is currently on the map?
It doesn't show very well on this map because we have the screen over
right.
It. Let me see if I can get that picture back. So on the left here, there is a fairly significant screen separating the accessway from the Vander Weidens property up until the point where you get to their driveway, I believe. I've visited the site, and it's maybe weeping cedar, some type of an evergreen there.
So it's basically the frontage, essentially, of Mr. Shaw's property?
Can you point it out on the map?
In a
it's a little difficult to see here because of the lines that we
sure.
have on the map, but it would be in this general location.
Okay, so all right, thank you.
Mr. Shaw's home is here, and then the Vander Weidens' home is here, and the hedge is right here.
Right. Did that answer your question, Councilor
yeah,
Nanke?
Thank you very much.
Okay, Councilor Dickey.
Thanks, Mayor. I'll see if I can ask this so it makes sense. I'm thinking about that easement and the possibility of putting multifamily, I mean, if this was opened up to putting multifamily there, I mean, that's not very wide. That's not like a regular street. It's 20 feet wide, so it's not the same size as a regular street. And one, I'm wondering, would there only be a certain number of driveways allowed off of like a development that would go there, and at what point is there a point where there is enough congestion where you say no, a driveway won't do it, you have to have a regular street with correct widths and everything? Does that make sense?
Yeah, Peter Fernandez, interim deputy city manager. Driveways are part of the site plan review, so when they come in for site plan review, then the width of that driveway will be discussed. Given the amount of traffic, it'd probably be wide enough to, you know, have a full lane in and a full lane out, and we can have discussions as to, you know, whether we want to have other appurtenances associated, you know, sidewalk, for example, associated with it. The one thing that is set, is my understanding, is the location of the driveway, and that's governed by the Oregon Department of Transportation. And my understanding is there's been even some additional meetings after we had the urban growth management preliminary declaration public hearing, and ODOT has pretty much said that that is the location where they want the driveway. But, you know, we can govern the design of that driveway as part of the site plan review.
Councilor Dickey?
Yeah, thanks. So that's part of the site plan review, but that's not, there's nothing right now that says, I mean, what I'm thinking of is put 20 apartments or something, you know, and you have a fairly narrow street that you've got a lot of cars coming in and out on something that's not even as wide as a regular street. Does that make sense? And is there anything that triggers that? I mean, if it's a kind of a plan, and I want to talk generically because I know we don't have a plan, but if there is a plan that wouldn't trigger something that would come back to us, is there the potential for many, many residences sharing this one narrow strip of driveway?
Well, my understanding is that this is, you know, this is private property, so it would be this development plus the homes that have the easement on it, and that would be it. It's not a public street. So it would be designed to accommodate the traffic generation from that development only. And that would be something that, again, would be addressed as part of the site plan review as to, you know, its sufficiency for accepting that traffic.
Thanks.
All right, Councillor Clem.
Yes, Peter, or maybe Vicki could help me with this question. Access in that site plan review process, which I know is not directly related to the annexation, but access to either Marine Drive or that Herrett Drive, I think that's Herrett, I don't remember the name of that street, actually, near the apartments there. Can there be a requirement that there be a valve on the north boundary of this property so that it can connect to other properties, or that?
It's hard for us to require a property owner to be dependent upon another property owner. We can require someone to make way for that access, but we can't require them to actually have to implement it if it's outside of their control.
Okay, yeah. And to get back to Peter's last comment, ODOT, obviously, I think staff has had discussions with ODOT. Can you change that driveway, which was the main concern of the neighborhood, not the annexation or the apartments, because this is really part of the West Salem neighborhood plan for RM housing there. True. I'm glad to see the change, the smaller amount, but really, I just want to confirm that we've checked with ODOT, and they will not allow us any jurisdiction to move that entry point.
That is my understanding, Councilor. I have not been personally attending the meetings, but my understanding from staff is that additional conversations have been had, and that is the location that they prefer.
Councilor Nanke.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. But in regards to access, it has nothing to do with the public hearing that we're dealing with this evening, correct? Because that could be a bare piece of land with no current driveway out onto the street, and we would look at it exactly the same as what we should be doing now.
That's true.
All right. Are there further questions? We will now ask our, Councillor Bennett, do you make a motion? Or Councillor Clem.
Rebuttal.
Sorry.
Is there a rebuttal?
Oh, is there a rebuttal? All right. And is there a rebuttal from the property owner, from the petitioner?
I just kind of like to address the screening issue that once this goes through design review, there's a in the Salem design code, there is buffer yards and fencing required for these apartment communities. So that will address, I believe, the neighbors' concerns about screening. So.
All right. Anything further? All right, Councillor Bennett, would you like to make a motion? I'll close the hearing. Thank you. I'm uncertain whether Councillor Clem would be introducing this motion since he's recused himself.
No, he hasn't recused. He just stated an ex parte contact.
Right. I disclosed.
Still. I see. All right. Well, then, Councillor Clem.
Thank you very much, Madam Mayor.
Thank you. Mm-hmm.
Yes, I move staff recommendation that this annexation be referred to the voters to the recommended action that's in your agenda.
Second.
It's been moved by Councillor Clem and seconded by Councillor Nanke to refer this petitioner-initiated annexation to the ballot. Is there discussion? Councillor Clem.
Please. Thank you, Madam Mayor. The concerns of the neighbors are still there. The stormwater management, piping it down to the Willamette River, it wouldn't be going downhill today. So I'm not sure where that came from, but I'm alleviated to know that there's fewer apartments, fewer cars, and that on-site drainage has been mentioned by the applicant, and that screening per city code will be done. And if that's whatever that distance is, that will be, it sounds like the applicants agreed to that to ensure that sufficient screening is there. The concern is still there. We've got more cars on Wallace Road than ever before. And the issue of asking us to hold the public hearing open to really take another swing at asking ODOT if they can allow for better access on Wallace Road just hasn't been successful. It's not fair to the property owners to hold them up for that. But I think the other thing that's important to note here is with our new process, it essentially council doesn't, the public doesn't, may not have as much visibility on what developments will look like. So I understand the rules, but we have conditioned annexations before. And if this is the public's only opportunity to understand what's coming their way, I think what we did here by holding the public hearing open was a good idea, because I'm not sure Mr. Shaw would have his ability to, and the neighborhood, the concern about access, if we hadn't. So while I don't like jerking around the applicant for annexation, I am concerned that we can increasingly become more transparent in land use matters and not problematic because we have one rule tripping over another. But I really believe that the annexation is something that the voters should have an opportunity to vote on. And this is part of the neighborhood plan. We West Salem does have planning that's done to show more multifamily, more affordable housing. And so we have to honor that as well. So I would encourage that you vote yes on it.
Thank you. Councillor Clausen? And then Councillor Nanke?
I just wanted to make one comment. My understanding of the code that it doesn't require screening. We're going through a conversation in South Salem right now about a set of residential or multifamily RM1. Same situation. And my understanding of code is it doesn't require screening. I don't know that we can ask staff that now that we've done with questions. I don't know if it makes a difference, but I just wanted to put my understanding. I still support it. I think we need the multifamily in Salem. West Salem and South Salem are both kind of the same in that we both need more multifamily, and I support that. I understand and am respectful of the concern on traffic, and I think that more conversation can be had there, but I'll be voting aye.
Councillor Nanke.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. I support the motion, but I wanted to clarify said motion, just knowing that this has to go forward, that basically the motion was to approve staff recommendation, of which part of that includes referring this to the ballot for the voters to determine whether or not to approve it.
All right, Councillor Clem?
Yeah, a question. Is it appropriate to clarify this screening buffer yard? What is in code?
Well, your hearing is really closed, so okay. Further evidentiary questions would.
All right. Well, my comment is that as the counselor for that ward, that will be a concern, obviously, when it comes through the land use process, that there be adequate buffer yard screening between the properties.
All right, Councilor Tesler.
I just wanted to, again, make note on page 33 of 63, item number 3, referring to storm drainage. The nearest public storm facility is a slough to the east of the subject property. An easement will be required to access this area. Then it goes on to speak to there will be impervious improvements added. Drainage from these improvements will flow onto tax lot 735, blah, 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 into the slough east of the subject property. I wasn't aware that sloughs were public storm facilities. I'm a little surprised to see this language in here. This is proposed findings demonstrated comprehensive plan and zone designation. I really think we need to rethink this language. Our sloughs are not public storm facilities. They are not to be used for those purposes. So I don't understand why this language is in here. If someone could explain that to me at another time, that would be great, but I don't think this is really appropriate language to be using.
All right, other comments or questions from councilors? All right, seeing none, we'll call for the question. Councilor Clem moved and Councilor Nanke seconded, referring this item to the ballot for the petitioner-initiated annexation. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed say nay. Motion carries. Did everyone vote? I'm just going to ask. It was unanimous. All right. It passes unanimously. Thank you very much. Did I say aye? I hope I did. All right. Thank you. All right. Our next item is order number 20-12-05. And let's see. We have closed the hearing on that item on March 23rd. So I would ask Councillor Bennett for a motion.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. I move staff recommendation.
It's been moved by Councillor Bennett and seconded by Councillor Nanke to move staff recommendation. Is there discussion? I'll call for the question. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed say nay. Motion carries unanimously. Thank you. We have special orders of business this evening. And the first one, I did not see Levi. Oh, there's Levi. Hello. Welcome. I was looking for you earlier. This will be a presentation from the Salem Social Service provider, Mano a Mano Family Center, Emergency Services and Self-Sufficiency. And Levi Herrera Lopez, right? Welcome.
Thank you, Mayor Taylor and City Council members. My name is Levi Herrera Lopez. I am Executive Director at the Mano a Mano Family Center with address at 3850 Portland Road in Ward 5. Mano a Mano Family Center is the oldest Latino-led organization in the Salem-Kaiser area and one of the oldest in all of Marion County with almost 25 years in existence. The goal of our programs is to support the development of strong, safe, healthy, and nurturing families and communities. In program year 2010 to 2011, more than 11,000 people benefited from a service offered by Mano a Mano Family Center, including emergency assistance, referral to community resources, after-school programs, education, and civic engagement. 4,375 of these were clients who received assistance during the time of crisis with support from the City of Salem and other funders such as the Oregon Community Foundation. I would like to share a story with you to illustrate our work. We've changed the names to protect our clients' privacy. Antonio came to request financial assistance to pay his rent. He has a young teenage daughter who was diagnosed with a severe illness. Antonio was the only person in the household who could drive, so he took his daughter to her many appointments. So many, in fact, that he was forced to quit his job. After conducting an intake and providing the family with an emergency food box, our staff attempted to connect him with resources available in the area. They did not qualify for any of them, and so they began to face the prospect of eviction. Our staff went above and beyond the call of duty and sought out other help through our networks, eventually finding support of a local Latino-owned business that offered a donation to help the family to cover their rent. This allowed the family to maintain stability while the father sought employment to continue supporting his family through their daughter's difficult situation. This story, unfortunately, is not so unique. Data collected by the state of Oregon still shows that Latino Oregonians are more likely to live in poverty than Latinos living anywhere in the country. Also, one in five Latino Oregonians are without health insurance, and in Marion County alone, one in three Latinos qualify to receive an emergency food box. Mano a Mano Family Center fills a unique role in the community in providing interventions which are culturally appropriate to this and other immigrant populations. And I'd like to close with a quote from Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. that summarizes the vision of my organization quite eloquently. Every human deserves three meals a day for their bodies, education and culture for their minds, and dignity, equality, and freedom for their spirits. Thank you, and I can answer any questions you might have.
Thank you very much. We appreciate the work that you do, and we appreciate you coming down this evening to tell us about it. Are there questions from counselors? Well, I would say keep up the good work.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. Our next presentation is from the Salem Senior Center Advisory Commission. This is their annual report. I understand Richard McGinty?
Correct, Madam Mayor.
President of the Salem Senior Center Advisory Commission is here. Welcome.
Thank you. Madam Mayor, council members, I'm Richard McGinty. I'm the current president of the Salem Senior Center Advisory Commission, and I'm here to present the 2011 annual report. You should have a copy of it, or it has been provided to you. The report outlines the accomplishments made this year in moving forward and accomplishing goals set forth in the Center 50-plus Strategic Operation Plan. Here I'll briefly cover 4 points. First, vitality. The center continues to work with the Friends of the Salem Senior Center, the business community, and senior patrons to raise necessary funds to support the center. Each year, we strive to reduce the general fund burden and work towards being a self-supporting operation. The center raised 56% of its operational funds this year and will incrementally increase this amount. We want to offer a special thanks to you and our business community for contributing over $37,000 in program sponsorships. The second item is collaboration. Through our current partners, the center has been able to leverage resources to sustain programming, grow programming, or meet new needs and serve a greater number of adults 50 and over. It is a good business to seek opportunities to partner in an effort to reduce duplication of our services in our community. 3, programming and community connections. The center serves on average 766 people daily. These attendees are enjoying nearly 200 different programs and services, and allows us to meet our mission to be the focal point for a full service 50 plus community center. Offerings include, and to meet the evolving needs and interests of adults age 50 and older, provisions of health and fitness, social connectedness, nutrition, volunteer opportunities, lifelong learning, information and referral, senior support services, employment and training, community leadership and civic engagement, and a designated facility for space for recreational activities. 4, volunteers. 706 volunteers contributed over 78,000 hours of service. This is an in-kind value of $1.6 million. Volunteers are our lifeblood. Each and every program at the center has a volunteer component. Center 50 Plus is truly a peer-driven model and has worked since it opened in 1996. In closing, I'd like to introduce two individuals. The first is Mr. Terry Pratt, if he can stand. He is also on the commission. And Marilyn Daly, our executive director, who we think very, very highly of. Finally, I'd like to thank you all. You've been very supportive of the Salem Senior Center, and I personally appreciate it, and I know everyone else at the center and on the commission does too. I'd be happy to entertain questions.
Thank you very much, and thank you for your service on that board of directors, and we appreciate so much the other gentleman's contributions as well, and all of the board members. Are there questions from councilors?
Thank you.
Thank you very much. I had the pleasure the other morning of actually visiting the Center 50 Plus for about I've been there several times. And Senator Merkley was touring and had a meeting there with providers. And he was most impressed with the facility, the physical facility, but also with the quality programs that are provided and just the spirit of the people who happened to be there that morning. He was very impressed, and I was very pleased. Thank you for what you're doing.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. Councilmember.
All right, we have a presentation by staff, which is a summary of the damage assessment and recovery efforts resulting from the January 2012 flood event. And I see we have a staff person here, Mark Bechtel, welcome.
The river runs through it.
Well, yeah.
Good evening, Madam Mayor and council members. My name is Mark Bechtel. I'm the Parks and Transportation Services Manager for Salem Public Works. And tonight I'd like to give you a presentation on the January 2012 flood and storm event that we had here in Salem. First, I want to give you a brief overview of the storm event itself, and then give you a tour of the damage assessment that occurred as we began to look and see the aftermath of the flood. And then give you a brief update on the recovery efforts that are underway currently. First, the storm event itself. And by the way, you're looking at Fairway Avenue southeast there, and in the distance you can see the bridge, the new brand new bridge, which is clearly above the stormwater. Just to give you a little tour, the one thing that's very important about this entire flood event is that this was a creek-driven flood event. And just for those who may not be unfamiliar with Salem's basins, this area down in here is the Battle Creek Basin. It has several creeks that flow into it: Walne, Scotch, Powell, Battle Creek, Jory Creek, Cinnamon Creek. They all flow here through Battle Creek, come together in a convergence, and then eventually connect with Mill Creek towards Turner. Another basin is the Pringle and Clark Creek Basin, which is in this area here, which eventually flows into the downtown core area and to the river. There's the Mill Creek Basin, which of course comes from Turner, comes through Salem, goes to the river. Shelton Ditch connects Mill Creek with Pringle Creek, as well as the Mill Race goes from Mill Creek to Pringle Creek. We have other basins in town. In West Salem, we have the Glenn and Gibson Basin, and we have the Claggett Basin up north, and then the Pudding River Basin off to the east. The flood event began, the flood event began the week before January 18th, when we began having a winter storm. We had snow and ice falling in Salem, and staff was actually responding to snow and ice issues the week before. That culminated with 3 to 6 inches of snow in the South Salem Hills on the 17th of January. Many of you may remember we had to go rescue Sprague High School and provide plowing services to get the buses out so the kids could get home. Then we had a lot of rain. And what you see here is our number of rain gauges that are throughout the region here. I would give you some particular note of this is rain gauge 11. It's on the Skyline Reservoir here in the South Salem Hills, kind of in the headwaters of Battle Creek. Over a five-day period of time, we had 9.01 inches of rain. Okay. The Salem Airport also saw a lot of rain. In fact, you could characterize the storm as a fire hose kind of hitting the South Salem area here with a tremendous amount of rain in a very short period of time. As far as magnitude of precipitation, again, 9.01 inches in the South Salem Hills. The 24-hour maximum was 4.77 inches. At the Salem Airport, we recorded 6.11 inches over a peak 48 hours. That is the highest 48-hour total ever recorded at the Salem Airport. You add all this rainfall on top of what was then melting 3 to 6 inches of snow in the South Salem Hills, and what resulted was a flood event. I'm going to give you a little bit of a tour of the creeks here. This is a graph of the flows on Battle Creek. The orange line and the red line you see across, these are actually two different creek gauges. And the orange and red lines are the high water watch lines. So this graph here is the upper reach of Battle Creek, just before Jory Creek comes into it. And you can see where it crested in the morning there, about 11:30 in the morning. And then further downstream on Battle Creek, you can see the tremendous rise in water that we had, a very rapid and sudden flood event where that crested just after noon on the 19th. The line you see here is the 100-year flood event line for water in that basin. So we had almost 2 feet of water over the 100-year flood event in that basin. Another example is Mill Creek. Again, two different flow gauges or stream gauges. One cresting sooner, the other one cresting much later at night. One reason why we had a higher crest later in the evening is because the Riverbend sand and gravel pits that overtopped their berm, and we had a kind of an additional slug of water that came down Mill Creek. So some residents that hadn't been flooded yet then became flooded later in the evening. A little bit about the city's response. As I mentioned, the week before we were busy responding to snow and ice, as well as earlier in the week. During the 18th of January, public works crews were feverishly clearing storm drains and grates and all sorts of stormwater infrastructure to try to keep ahead of the storm. At 6 a.m. On the 19th, we opened up the Salem Public Works Department's departmental operating center at the shops, where we could coordinate all the different divisions of public works responding to the event. Then at 9 a.m. on the 19th, the city manager and Chief Niblock of the fire department opened up the city's emergency operations center. That operations center went for three 12-hour shifts. Our interim public works director was the incident commander for two of those shifts, Robert Chandler, and then police chief was the incident commander for the overnight shift, Jerry Moore. That operations center then closed as the floodwaters receded at noon the next day on the 20th. The public works operating center stayed open until the early morning hours of about 2:30 in the morning the following day, because we thought we were going to have a windstorm, and which thankfully did not come. It came today instead, and so. We were pleased that we didn't have winds on top of the flood at that time. Just to point out there, in the Emergency Operations Center, you can see us gathered there. We are discussing at that moment how to evacuate people from different places around town, including people who didn't necessarily want to evacuate, and how we could assist them in that effort. Of course, one of the shining moments of this event was how Salem's community responded with volunteer efforts. Whether it was neighbor helping neighbor or organized community efforts, either way, there was literally hundreds. In fact, we estimate over 1,600, if not 2,000, community volunteers helping each other fill sandbags, man pre-designated sandbag sites, helping neighbors, really a community-wide effort to assist with the flood event. Some preliminary statistics as we finished the event. 207 homes were impacted by flood water as reported by the Red Cross. The city of Salem distributed either empty or full 220,000 sandbags. We evacuated approximately 300 people and from their homes due to the high water, and we had 64 different streets or bridges closed at the height of the event due to high water. Just the cost of responding to the event during the actual event itself was $275,000 to the city. So just a little bit of tour of what the flood was like around different parts of town and the damage. When we presented our initial briefing to FEMA on February 6th, we estimated $10.3 million in damage due to the flood, ranging from $1.3 in parks to city buildings, $1 million for general infrastructure, and bridges at $7.9. We've been refining that cost, and I'll show you later what the current refined costs are. As far as damage goes, the green dots on the map there are individual damage areas. The red lines are street closures, and the yellow areas are areas that were impacted by high water. Starting with South Salem, areas that were damaged were the area of around the area of the Battle Creek Golf Course, the former golf course, where the four creeks converge. And you can see the street closures and areas of inundation there, as well as areas around Woodmansee Park and Croyson Creek as well. Just to give you some pictures, that's the Battle Creek area. That's looking at Fairway Avenue, southeast. That's the intersection of Madras and Commercial, where you see the school bus that had a hard day that day. All the students were evacuated successfully from the school bus. And then some of the areas, I believe that's a home on 13th Avenue or close by, one of the streets close by. Another area of Battle Creek, I would mention that Councilor Clausen was very visible during that whole time with the neighbors out there, working very closely with them. Holder Lane Southeast, this is Walm Creek as it runs alongside the road. You can see how it incised the ditches there, undermined some pavement, and completely blew out a decorative wall. At Mildred Lane and Trilogy Street Southeast, we have a stormwater detention basin, again, that was completely blown out by flood water and will have to be completely rebuilt. Along Reese Hill Road Southeast, we had a 14-inch water main that was undermined, and we had to turn it off so we wouldn't lose it. That greatly decreased water flow to that part of the neighborhood. We were able to maintain potable water through a very small water line, but we had no fire flow for most of the day that day until we could get the water line put back securely in place and armored. Most of us are used to flooding at Mental Run Island Park, but we had a tremendous amount of flooding at Mental Run Island Park this time as the Willamette River rose to just under 30 feet at the Salem Gauge. This is taken immediately at the entrance to the park there off of South River Road. When the waters receded, we have a lot of gravels on the paths and some very, very large trees that were left floating across our paths and bridges. Woodmansee Park also had backing up waters there. A number of footbridges were impacted, as well as brushing trees across the paths. So you get into Central Salem, you can see the impacts of damages in that area as far as inundation in the residential areas. State Street, this is where Mill Creek crosses State Street. That's the used to be the Duck Inn, now it's Muchas Gracias. And you can see the State Street Bridge there is overtopped. Quite a bit of flooding in the residential neighborhood there in the State Street and Richmond areas. This is North Salem High School sports field. This is a brand new synthetic turf field installed summer of 2011 after tremendous efforts by the alumni and the faculty and students and the whole community there to have gotten that synthetic field in place and then to have it undermined by the flood is it's a kind of a tragic thing. They are working to repair it and get it ready for use. What you see here is not a creek. This is Bellevue and Street and Pringle Parkway. This is Lindsay Towers, which had to be evacuated during the night. This is where Shelton Ditch overflowed its banks and ran into the surrounding area around Salem Hospital and Safe. If I had some video clips, but they take too long to spool up in this presentation. If anyone wants to see them, you're welcome to come to my office and we can watch video clips. But some tremendous volumes of water coming through the hospital at this point, through their parking garage, along the Shelton Ditch. This is the high water mark for that area next to the hospital. What you see here is Pringle Park, where Pringle Creek and the Shelton Ditch have a confluence, and so Pringle Park is completely underwater. This is Pringle Community Hall in the background here. It had 29 inches of water inside of it. Many of you may remember back to the 1996 flood where the building was essentially destroyed. It was rebuilt with a flood resistant design, and it actually did what it was supposed to do. The building was not damaged in any tremendous way. During the early morning hours of January 19th, we had inmate crews and park staff remove all the appliances as water was coming into the building. And there's a loft that's up above that we were able to put all the furniture in. So we did have to, of course, clean out the building, sanitize it. We had a wedding event scheduled for February 10th. The invitations had been sent out. The bride and groom and the mom were all very, very anxious. And I'm happy to say that we had the building ready 2 days before that event, ready to go and everything fine. Winter Street Southeast Bridge over Shelton Ditch suffered what may end up being fatal damage to the bridge. It's one of our bridges that is still, it's the only bridge that's closed to traffic right now and remains closed. The underwater inspections we received from ODOT are that the footings of the bridge piers in the water have all been exposed or undermined to some degree. The south wall has been undermined. In fact, if you look very closely at the railing, you can see there's a sag. So we are in the process of, I'll talk about that in a minute with our recovery efforts. We're in the process of working with ODOT and Federal Highway Administration on an engineering analysis that will determine whether it's better to try to repair the bridge or to simply replace it. It's an 84-year-old bridge, so we'll have to do some cost analysis as to what's the most prudent thing to do. Southeast Salem, some more damage. We had to evacuate the manufactured home parks that are here along Turner Road. Here's where the down here's the area where the Riverbend sand and gravel overtopping occurred, and quite a few street closures. Weir Dam, for those who don't know where Weir Dam is, that is where Shelton Ditch diverges from Mill Creek, and this is the diversion structure that controls the flows between the two. It has been severely undermined. This area here is completely undermined. The creek literally went around the structure and scoured out a huge area here. So right now we have it, a preliminary estimate of $500,000 of damage to that. It could be significantly more pending a complete analysis by an engineer. The motoring public did not do well on McGillcrest Street that day. Gilmore Field off of Hoyt Street did what it was supposed to do, which was to act as a regional detention basin. It did overtop, and you can see the water flowing down Berry Street at that point. We actually have pictures of South Salem High School students with a canoeing through Gilmore Field. In West Salem, the only damage from creeks occurred in Orchard Heights Park from Glen Creek. The rest of the damage was a result of the high river levels at the Willamette River. You're looking at Wallace Marine Park from the Union Street Railroad Bridge and Trestle. Where you see this little bit of turbulence here, that is the new walkway that comes down from the bridge. It was undermined, as you can see on the left, and large amounts of gravels were all over our soccer fields and sports fields. This is the damage done to the Wallace Marine softball complex. Some of the outfield fences were destroyed. Large trees came in and actually floated over them and landed in our infields. That is the warning track. And you can see just how high the water was by the line of debris caught in the fence. That all the infields ended up here. Okay. And again, another shot of the warning track. We went into recovery mode immediately after the floodwaters receded. We sent out damage assessment teams. They spent the entire weekend cataloging all the damage, high water areas, all the areas of damage, and inventorying them. We had to get ready for the FEMA briefing on February 6th, and we have continued to work a lot to prepare all the documentation for FEMA and for Federal Highway Administration, and to try to get some of these repairs underway. The city manager instructed us that we needed to follow four priorities when it came to recovery efforts. One was restoring critical infrastructure and services. Another was maintaining public safety. Three, getting our revenue-generating facilities back online, and then general cleanup and repair. We were able to get Pringle Community Hall back online in time for the wedding, so it could generate revenue again. Our biggest challenge right now is trying to get the Wallace Marine Softball Complex ready for spring league play by mid-April. We are in the process of putting out a contract to bring in a professional contractor that can make those repairs to tournament level fields, is which we have. We have national level tournament level fields that cannot be just put together with a bunch of volunteers. They have to be put together professionally. One of our concerns after the flood was cleaning up areas that had sanitary sewer overflows, and those areas have all been sanitized and cleaned. We still are dealing with the Winter Street Bridge over Shelton Ditch. We are involved in the federal assistance process. We initially briefed FEMA and took them on tours the first week of February. The Small Business Administration came and assessed the damage. And a number of our bridges, five bridges, are covered under the Federal Highway Administration Emergency Response Program, and then the rest under FEMA. So we're dividing our efforts between different federal agencies, helping them inventory our needs. And we were fortunate to have a presidential federal disaster declaration issued on March 2nd of this year. Right now, we are very busy doing work with FEMA on getting each individual repair project approved so that we can try to get reimbursement on each of those projects. We received a public assistance declaration, and what that means, there's two different types of federal assistance. Public assistance means assistance for public infrastructure. So that would be municipal infrastructure, state infrastructure, county infrastructure. It also covers nonprofits like hospitals. It also covers school districts. It does not cover individual property owners, though. That's under the individual assistance effort. And the president did not issue an individual assistance declaration. He still may. They're still working to see if we can reach those criteria. But at the moment, we do have an approval for the Small Business Administration to begin offering some levels of assistance to businesses. But without that individual assistance declaration, that area of assistance is somewhat limited. Where we do, though, have assistance on the way is in our public infrastructure, both through FEMA and through the Federal Highway Administration. We revised our damage assessment findings, and they're in the staff report that are submitted to you. Our damage to city parks, thankfully, has been reduced from $1.3 million. We've refined that down to just under $900,000. Our street drainage, water and sewer damage also has been reduced. But again, the big unknown there is the damage to Weir Dam, and that could rise significantly. One of the things that FEMA looks for are projects that we can do in the future that would provide future mitigation against future floods. And one of the ones that we have pointed out to them is the damage that continues to occur along the Willamette Riverbank next to our boat ramp at Wallace Marine Park. That area, that riverbank, continues to be eroded away and scoured away. And frankly, if we don't do something in the next couple of years, we may lose our second boat ramp. We've already lost one to a sandbar. We may lose our second one to erosion. We've secured a resource agency and Corps of Engineers permit, but we've never had the money to actually go ahead and do the project. So FEMA was very interested in seeing if they could explore the idea of a mitigation project to help us in that area. Bridge damage is still hovering at about $7.4 million. And then here's just a summary of the, what I would consider the our high price or major repair projects. A number of them are bridges, repairs to Weir Dam, and then repairs to the Wallace Marine Softball Complex. Every one of those, we hope to receive some level of federal assistance, either through FEMA or FHWA. I can't stand here and tell you what those actual reimbursements will be. Many of the, with the bridges, many of the damage is prorated based on the age of the bridge, how much damage or scour occurred prior years. So I can only tell you that we will receive some level of reimbursement and assistance yet to be determined. One of the things the city manager directed us to do was to look at ways to prepare for the next flood, whether it's 80 years in the future, 60 years in the future, 100 years in the future, or next week. We want to be prepared for a future event. One of the things that we're looking at is how to enhance our early warning system for creek flooding. We have been largely preparing for floods that occur due to the river backing up creeks. And this was a more traditional or, you know, classic, I can't call it a flash flood because it was too long a duration, but it was a very sudden rise in creeks, which is something that we want to get better at predicting those through enhancing our creek gauge system, our rain gauges, and just our general ability to deploy forces sooner. We want to work to improve our public notification, and when I'm done here, Mike Gottabau will show you our new and improved emergency website for when the city has emergencies. We've already identified two additional pre-arranged sandbag locations in the far southeast to help out in the Battle Creek area if and when the flooding ever occurs there again. And we are very much involved in identifying what improvements we may need to make in a, from a capital improvement program perspective to help with future flooding. We're going to hold three public open houses so we can exchange information on floods on the 20th, 21st, and 22nd. We're doing it by basin. The focus on Pringle and Clark Creek basins will be at South Salem High School in the library on the 20th from 5 to 7 p.m. The focus on the Mill Creek Basin and Shelton Ditch the following evening at Pringle Community Hall, and then a focus on the Battle Creek Basin Thursday night, the 22nd. During these events, we hope to do a combination of gathering information from people who are impacted by the flood to make sure we have all of our records complete and we know areas that are impacted, gain any information and that we need, that we can get from folks. And we also want to provide information on how the city deals with stormwater drainage, with sanitary sewer, with FEMA, floodplain issues, flood insurance, how they can become as involved as volunteers and through the CERT teams, and really just have it be an exchange of information with the public. So at this point, I'm going to let Mike Gottabau show you our new and improved emergency website, and then I'm available for any questions you might have.
Thank you very much, Mr. Bechtel. That really was a very informative and easy to understand report. Thank you so much. And the pictures certainly tell the story too.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. Mike Gottabau. I'm Mike Gottabau and Public Works staff in the City Manager's Office. During the flood, one of the things we did is we made extensive use of the City of Salem website to show people which streets were closed, where sandbag locations were. And following that, we decided we would enhance that capability because putting it on our existing website was not as clean as it could have been. So what we did was we created an alternate, essentially home page that we can switch to whenever we get into an event of this kind. And I'm waiting for the, on the left there, this is actually, the map is not available. This is actually an interactive map. There it is, okay. Where we can put information regarding what's going on with an event. You can click on a feature that would be on this map, and it would give you information about what is happening at that location in the community. We have tabs for our road closures, our sandbag locations, if there's evacuations, shelters involved, if we've done any media releases, volunteer information. And also, we've added to the website, there's the NOAA weather information, how to volunteer or ask for volunteers. The river gauges, school closings. What we've tried to do is put everything that has to do with the emergency that's going on in one location to make it easier for people to find. And we have a way here at the top where you can navigate back to the City of Salem website, either there or there. But this actually would become our alternate homepage. So if you went to cityofsalem.net, this is where you would go when we get into a situation like this. We've set it up pretty much right now just for floods, but we're going to be making some additional enhancements so they'll be able to cover snow and ice, any public safety events, other types of things that may go on. We'll be able to get people directed to this and get them the information they need as soon as possible. And I'll be glad to answer any questions.
Thank you very much. I'm really happy to see how quickly that the staff were able to put that website together. That's really helpful. I believe Councillor Clem had his hand up.
Thank you, Madam Mayor.
Yes.
Mike, today, principal of Walker called me and said, hey, we've got a tree that's kind of rolling down the hill here. Windstorms. Nobody knows whose property is. Nobody knows who's supposed to take care of the tree. I am just absolutely fabulously complimentary of City Public Works and our great workers out there who responded right away. They made the tough call right away. It doesn't matter whose tree it is. It's looming over a middle school. They did the right thing and they took care of it. I hope nobody gets a bill. But I think the issue is that, all this is information. How do they contact the city through emergency? Can you show us a little bit about, hey, what do I do? There's a tree rolling down the hill.
There on the same page, we have a 911 number, the number for Public Works Dispatch, Police Non-Emergency. A hotline, if we were to establish a hotline like we did during the January flood, and Red Cross information. So for something like this, I would call the Public Works Dispatch as the most the place that would get the information to.
And the only reason I bring that up is I'm not sure the public knows that Public Works Dispatch is who you call. Dispatch sounds like it's an internal function. So, questions about what you think might be an emergency, call this number. I'm not trying to detail out your website, but I think I had to look up the number and figure it out, and then after transferred twice, got to the right person. So I'm just wondering if maybe we can't
we
make
can
it
change the word
absolutely
that's
clear in an emergency that's not life-threatening, call this number.
We can do that, absolutely.
I think Mr. Chandler was going to say something.
Yeah, Robert Chandler, Interim Director of Public Works. Yes, Councilor, it's a good idea. We could probably just add a tab on the right-hand side for, questions or points of contact where you can further describe, what is Public Works Dispatch, what types of calls we get, what calls go to emergency, what is the purpose of the hotline, things like that. Good,
again,
good
great job to staff and somebody making the right call out there. A lot of folks in the area very much appreciate it.
Councilor Nanke, did you have a question?
Yes, thank you, Madam Mayor. Okay. And I know we have Public Works Dispatch defined as far as what things to call it for somewhere, because I've seen them, because a lot of people don't. It's like there's foam floating down the creek, Public Works Dispatch. There's a pothole, Public Works. This, a whole bunch of things. I would assume that caches for CERT would be located on the map eventually as well. As a resource to the community?
That's an excellent question. I'd have to check with Roger Stevenson, the emergency management preparedness manager for the city. Whether they actually want the caches, you know, publicly advertised or not, I don't know. But that'd be a good question. We can get back to you on that, Councilor.
Okay, because I know in Morningside's case, the cache is also at an assembly area. The Morningside Methodist people have opened up their church facility, except for the sanctuary, to people in the community, as long as they're still standing, in the event that there's a, you know, large-scale earthquake or whatever, and buildings and homes are damaged.
Yeah, we can get back to you on that and find out what their protocol is for that.
Okay, here's a big question. Minto Brown Island Park. We sold an easement in regards to some planting. I've heard that plants were actually planted in said easement. Did they survive? And what's the rest of that easement actually look like as water flowed through it? And did we scour and lose some, or?
Actually, Councilor, we were very pleased to find out that those plantings survived quite well. In fact, they're thriving. So really our compliments to the crews that planted them and the good job they did. And really the we were out there with some state folks this last week, and the whole area looks like there never was a flood in those easement areas.
Excellent. Because then the next question would have been, who has to pay to replace them if they were gone?
If there is eventually any damage or die off within the next 2 years, then the NRCS will pay for that. There's a 3-year establishment period. After that, it would be on our dime.
So even if there's an act of God, say a flood that scours out and rips all their plantings out, they would still replace them on their dime?
That's our understanding.
Okay. Councilor Dickey?
Yeah, I have a couple things. Thanks for the presentation. That was really helpful to have that, and for the website too. I think it's going to be a really good resource. Just a couple things. One, the English teacher in me just says there's a typo on your tabs at Willamette Gauge.
Oh, yes.
Is not spelled correctly, so just make a note of that,
my
please.
Apologies.
I want to take my red pen and, you know, mark up my screen, so not a good idea. The other thing is, what jumps out to me that I don't see on here is transit information, because in the event of, you know, flood or snow or whatever, a lot of times people can't get out with their own vehicles, so they rely on public transportation, and transit is often detoured or things like that during an event like this. Would it be possible to include that as well?
That's an excellent point. Yes, we'll get a hold of transit, and we'll find out what's the best information and way to address that.
Thanks.
And I'd also like to add, if I may, that the transit district, they were an integral part of our operations at the City Operations Center. They provided buses to assist, if necessary, with evacuating people. They were with us the entire time, and really, we our compliments to them for their assistance with us.
Are there other questions from councilors? All right, thank you very much. We really appreciate such a complete report. And again, my kudos to the entire city staff, the emergency responders, our partners, the Salem Kaiser Transit District, Salem Kaiser Schools, American Red Cross. There may have been others that were
ODOT, was very helpful with some of the issues we had. We were in close communication with the governor's office. Really, everyone we worked with just was tremendously helpful.
Very helpful. Statesman Journal was right up to the minute with news from us, and working very well with our staff people who were working on our public information. So I felt like there was a very instant coordination from the city, and thanks to good planning and good training. Good. Thank you very much. All right, we have another item that is an addition, as described earlier in the evening, and it's now item 5D. You have it as an extra, and I believe our city attorney, Randall Tosh, is going to discuss filling council vacancy. Mr. Tosh?
Well, actually, I thought Councilor Bennett was going to make a motion.
Oh, all right. Councilor Bennett, do you have a motion?
I do have a motion.
All right. Thank you.
Madam Mayor, I move we accept Councilor Bob Cannon's resignation declare the Ward 7 seat vacant, and direct the city manager to provide public notice of the vacancy so that we can fill it.
It's been moved by Councillor Bennett and seconded by Councillor Clem. Is there discussion?
We'll miss him, but he's gone.
And yes.
I know he's watching, but
Thank you.
I really hope that we can send along a letter from the manager and mayor thanking Bob for his excellent service to the city and let him know how much we'll miss him. He's been just a really wonderful colleague on the city council, so we will miss him.
Wonderful. I think Councillor Nanke, did you have your hand up?
Yes, thank you, Madam Mayor. Just similar. Bob brought a lot of expertise from times way back when through different fields that we could have never gotten information on as quickly from one source. I enjoyed it, my time serving with him on council. But there's an issue with Ward 7. And this is the third councillor now that's left their seat early. So when you guys pick your new person, ask them if they're going to stay around till the end.
Some of us never leave.
That's right.
Yeah. There is a law against indentured servitude, though.
That's right.
Except for you and you and you and you. Okay. All right. We have a motion on the floor, moved by Councillor Bennett and seconded by Councillor Clem to receive Councillor Bob Cannon's resignation from council. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed say nay. Motion carries unanimously. Thank you. And now I believe, will our city attorney discuss the procedure or was I misinformed?
No one told me.
Oh, all right. Well, there is a report here, and so we will follow the rules of the procedures, and we will be announcing this vacancy and moving forward with the regular process for filling the position. Councillor Clem, did you have a comment or question?
Yes, I do, Madam Mayor. Just in the interest of people who may not know the regular process, I was hoping that we could articulate that we will go through a selection process here on council for what period of time for Ward 7?
We will send a notice out announcing the vacancy, and I'm thinking 2 to 3 weeks. I want to look at how we've done this before and make sure we have an adequate amount of time. And interested people who meet the qualifications will send in their information expressing their interest. Then it will go to a selection committee, which I'm assuming you'll want to use your boards and commission committee for the first review. Their recommendations would come to city council. You can add someone at that time if there are other applicants.
Well, that's not exactly. Okay. It does work a little bit differently.
Your memory's coming back.
My memory is coming back. If you want to know the way the process works.
Sorry to hold this over. I just want to make sure we're clear about what we're doing.
It's controlled by Council Rule 19, which is the appointments rule. The city manager is supposed to advertise the vacancy so that adequate notice is given. There will be a deadline for the submission of applications. At that time, it goes to the Boards and Commissions Appointments Committee for recommendation to the council. It comes back to the full floor of the council. The council then can consider the recommendations of the Boards or Commissions Committee, but can appoint anyone that filed an application. So there's a deadline, and once that deadline is passed, the applications are closed. Then the council makes a determination whether it'll conduct interviews. It doesn't have to. And then after that, you take a vote. And then there's a procedure on determining if you have more than two applicants, how that vote is determined.
And then that person will serve the balance of Councillor Cannon's term.
That is correct, until November, or until January, until the successor is sworn in.
Yes, Councillor Bennett.
and I don't want to prolong it either, but I do hope as the manager puts this together, I think one of the things we're looking at is having a counselor on the budget committee as quickly
That's
as
right.
possible, and that begins April 4th. So
That's right.
I'm sort of looking at that as the kind of deadline, if that's reasonable to you.
That's what I'm hoping, that 2 weeks would be adequate notice, and I'm sure the Statesman Journal will help us get the word out.
Yeah. Okay.
Top of the pool.
He's got it. All right.
That or smoke signals, huh?
Yes. Okay. Are there any further questions? Councillor Nanke.
Yeah, I just want to say that those people who may not be familiar with it, that's how Councillor Bennett got here a few years back as well, and they may be confused because there was only Councillor Bennett who actually came, didn't have to campaign, didn't have to do anything, just had to turn in a piece of paper and show up here. So I would
there
encourage
politics
any and all from
fastest.
Ward 7 to throw their name in the hat. Easy way to get, if nothing else, a short-term stint on the council rather than a couple of decades.
All right. We will move along. There's no unfinished business. There are information reports in the council packet. If there are any questions on those reports, we have no ordinances this evening coming before us. We do have public comment. We have a gentleman signed up, Mel Magster. Pretty close, Mel
Moxter.
All right, thank you. Welcome.
My name is Mel Moxter. I live 2145 U Street Southeast. Kind of rebuttal to what you have to say. I am here because of the flooding of Gilmore Field in January of 2012. Improper management of Clark Creek was the reason for Gilmore Field to overflow at Berry and Hoyt Streets. Clark Creek was clogged with debris at a steel grate on the south side of Hoyt Street culvert. Farther downstream, midway between Electric and Rural Streets, another steel grate was clogged with debris. North of Rural Street, Clark Creek was flowing about one-third capacity. Why was the creek only one-third capacity? The answer is simple. The creek could not flow properly because of the grates were clogged with storm debris. Who's responsible for keeping the storm debris from backing up on the steel grates? I have lived in South Salem neighborhood for 43 years and witnessed Clark Creek flooding in 1970, 71, 72, 74, and 75, and 1996. The city of Salem received complaints from a resident at 2120 U Street in 1975 about the danger of Clark Creek's flooding. The city did a study, and their solution was to completely enclose Clark Creek in a 5-foot cement tile from Hoyt Street to Bush Park. I had purchased my home because of Clark Creek's flowing through my yard. It was comforting and very pleasant to have a flow of water next to your home, especially with the wildlife, trout, crayfish, all kinds of animal life. I complained to the city council and wrote letters to the editor of the local newspaper. I did not want this creek to be destroyed by enclosing it in a cement tile. The city engineers came up with an alternative plan. In 1976, they riprapped the creek from Hoyt Street to midway between Electric and Rural Streets. From there, the creek was enclosed with a 5-foot tile to Rural. From Rural to Howard Streets, the creek was lined with concrete slabs forming a large canal-like ditch. This is right in back of South Salem High School. From Howard Street north to Bush Park, the creek was entombed in a 5-foot concrete tile pipe. Gilmore Field was excavated to form a retention basin for excessive water during heavy rainfalls. It worked perfect. Clark Creek did not flood for the next 20 years. The primary reason for its not flooding was because Jack Foster, now deceased, and I were in flood watch mode whenever the creek rose to a certain height. The two of us would remove the debris piled up at the grate located midway between Electric and Rural, eliminating the threat of a flood. Had we not removed the debris, Clark Creek would flood and cause damage to properties on Rural Street, and I could possibly lose a bridge along with the water supply to my home. In 1996, Clark Creek was overflowed and water poured out of Clark Creek and down U Street to flood
rural streets. I failed to tell you about the time limit, but the 3 minutes of your testimony time has expired. Is your statement very much longer? Can
about
you kind
a,
of
about a minute and a half.
Speed forward? Can you kind of speed forward?
We okay. have.
Okay. Thank you.
The engineers built a flood gate on the south side of Hoyt Street, and they enclosed a steel grate for safety reasons. Okay, and that's just plugged up with debris. To keep Gilmore Field from filling and overflowing, the steel grate should be removed to allow the creek to flow without interruption, allowing Gilmore Field to collect excess water during heavy rainfalls as it was intended. Basically, that's it.
Okay. All right.
Seen a lot of flooding.
Right. Well, thank you very much for coming this evening and providing that testimony for us. Thank you. All right. I see no further business to come before the council. I have no mayor's items or councilor's items. The meeting is adjourned.